Hi, everyone. Thank you for the introduction, Gula. And Reed, thank you to everybody at Atheist United for having me here. And this is great to see everybody here right now. So I'm going to, my talk today is called Non-Believers in the Muslim World. We hear about this all the time. You know, we know that there's a lot of large ex-Muslim community around the world. We've seen them online. We've seen them all sort of do that with a lot of prominent figures like Faisal Batar and Maryam Namazi. There's many people sort of leading the effort. But this is just, this is based on a chapter in my upcoming book that brings a more personal side to it. So I'm just gonna go ahead and start. I'm 5 years old. I'm standing next to my dad in the large upstairs bedroom at my aunt's house in London, England. Everyone's gathered in the room, my parents, siblings, aunts and uncles. My cousin and playmate, Sana, is lying on the bed. She has childhood leukemia and her battle is coming to an end. We're all here to be with her in her last moments to say goodbye. She's 3 years old. So I'm holding on to my dad's forearm and I watch as my aunt and my mother sit by Sana's bed. They're crying and praying desperately as she gasps for breath. She's pale and she's weak. She's likely been given large amounts of sedatives, morphine, just to help ease her passing. But watching her now makes it clear that a lot of her pain is breaking through. Cancer doesn't discriminate. There's no reason that she should have it any easier than anyone else. Cancer doesn't care if you're 80 or if you're 3. So I turned to my dad, and I used to call him Baba, and I was like, Baba, what's happening to Sana? And he looks down at me, and he says, she's returning to God. God is taking her back so she can be with him again like she was before. And he makes it sound as if that's a good thing, but I'm looking around this room and nothing that I'm seeing feels like a good thing. My mother and my aunt, they're reading from the Quran, their faces are drenched with tears, and I ask them, like, what are they doing? What are Ammi and Khala? Khala is what we call, what means aunt in Urdu. And I ask them, what are they reading? You know, why are they praying so hard? They don't want Sana to go, Ali, he tells me. They're praying to God, they're begging him to let her stay and to stop her pain. God doesn't do either of those things that day. Her pain gets worse. She struggles harder and harder to breathe. Her gasping becomes more and more pronounced. And then, finally, it stops. So my three-year-old cousin, Sana, is dead. Everyone in the room is drained. My aunt and my uncle, her parents, are inconsolable. I'm angry. I remember I'm 5 years old. You know, I've been playing on the playground. I've been in sort of preschool, kindergarten, and so on. And I'm seeing this as a gruesome game of tug of war between God and the rest of us. And this is unseen being who my parents have told me is all powerful and can do anything he wants. He's on one end of the rope, and he barely even has to try, obviously. And we're all on the other end, and we're tugging with all our might, and obviously, it's hopeless. And he doesn't, it's not like he pulls the rope quickly in one fell swoop to win. No, he keeps tugging for a while. He stretches out the agony over time. Gradually, we amp up our struggle. And you know, he makes us increase our struggle slowly and agonizingly, like a trained torturer. And we don't even have the remotest hope of winning. We never did. It's cruel, it's sadistic, and it's obscene. Yet, they're all praying to him. They're begging him to save Sana. But from whom? Himself? You know, if I, as a five-year-old, if I can see that this is a scam, surely they will too, right? But no, almost every ritual in the immediate days after Sana's death, whether it's the funeral prayers or the burial ceremony, seems to involve God as a positive character, despite what he did to her. He's being prayed to. He's being asked to bless her and take care of her in heaven just hours after he painfully and callously took her away. So I must be missing something. After all, I'm just a kid. They're grown-ups, they have university degrees, they have well-paying jobs. Maybe there's something they're not telling me that would make sense of all of this. But I don't dare to ask the question. I know that's a really bad thing to do. I've been told that I should fear God, but I've also been told to love God more than anything else. It's that fear-love combination that I would learn later that is the heart of what drives the battered woman syndrome or the master-slave relationship. She's in heaven, Ali. It's the best place in the universe. God has called her back. Once you go there, you never die, they tell me. Well then, why don't we all go there right now, right? Why are we still here if it's so nice up there? Why are we so sad for her, actually? Shouldn't we be happy? And how do you know in the first place? Have you seen heaven? Has anyone been there and come back to tell us all about it? If God loves her so much, why did he make her suffer so horrifically before taking her? If we're taking so much comfort in God, why do we behave as if he doesn't even exist at all? Why do we behave as if all of this is so permanent, that death is so permanent? And then right there, years before I would even know the meaning of the word skepticism, its seeds have been sown. So once you've learned to be skeptical, it's almost impossible to unlearn it. Critical thinking fosters curiosity and it widens the intellect. One finds value in truth and the process of seeking it. And the skeptical bent that I had acquired at the time of Sana's death would revisit me frequently over the following years, particularly when my family moved to Saudi Arabia. It's a birthplace of Islam, Muhammad, the Quran. And, you know, aside from forget about the Islam thing, just look at religion in general. I would see tearful survivors of plane crashes on television, profusely grateful to God for saving them. And I'd immediately wonder, as many of you probably did too, you know, what did the dozens of other passengers do, the ones who actually perished? What had they done wrong not to deserve that honor? I would see post-soccer game interviews, the winning team captain, you know, claiming God's blessing, you know, God blessed us and that's why we won. You see that with basketball and other sports here as well. And I would wonder what the other teams possibly could have done to make themselves so unworthy of this divine endorsement. So in simple everyday rituals, even like listening to my elders thanking God before dinner, I would just in my mind wonder if a more honest prayer would be something like, thank you, Lord, for providing us with lots of extra, sure to be wasted food tonight, instead of giving it to those kids in Ethiopia who are starving to death. And then there were the unburned books, year after year. You know, there would be a fire in a church or an explosion in a mosque that would kill people, but miraculously leave a Bible or Quran untouched. This is a miracle, by the way. So all these smug, you know, I told you so faces would be all over the TV, and they would be quoting Isaiah 48 from the Bible to explain this marvel, which says, the grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God endures forever. And over in Riyadh, it was verse 9 of Al-Hijr, which is the 15th surah or chapter in the Quran. Indeed, it is we who sent down the Quran, and indeed, we will be its guardian. That's why it survived. So thus worked the Almighty's miracle. Let the people burn, but save those 699 paperbacks, which can also be perused for free at nearly every mosque and virtually every hotel room. So I would feel strange asking God for things. You know, I was relatively privileged. You know, I was part of a well-off family, had well-educated parents. They were sending me to a good school. It seemed that my prayers usually came true whether I asked for something or not. Whenever I'd ask for my school exams to go well, and just a footnote here is that whenever it was exam time, that's the time when I was most resolutely devout. I would secretly imagine God replying. Yes, Ali, I will help you get an A on that chemistry test tomorrow. As soon as I'm done setting off this Ebola epidemic in Africa, then I'm all yours. So, and I would chuckle to myself at the absurdity of it all. And this happened almost on a daily basis. I just see, on every day I would see these things. But none of the adults seemed to see it like I did. And I was very quiet about it. I never dared to bring it up with them. But times are changing. Today I know that acute lymphoblastic leukemia, which is the blood cancer that Sana had, is not just treatable, but curable. It's one of the few cancers where, you know, it's regularly cured. And there's been a tremendous amount of progress in the last several decades. In fact, survival rates are, by some accounts, are up to 90% now. And of course, the number of children who have benefited from these recent medical advancements is a tiny fraction of the countless children who died from it prior to, say, 1980. Now think about that survival rate for a second. It's 90%. And this is what scientists and physicians have achieved in the last 35 years. Today, after they inform their informed parents that their toddler has blood cancer, they can then proceed to treat them successfully and allow them to live normal, fulfilling lives. So it's no surprise that it's thought of as a miracle, one that many of these children's parents end up thanking God for. But unlike today's pediatric oncologists, God was always there, supposedly, you know, for millennia upon millennia, well before 1980. For children who had the disease before that, like Sana, these miracles were few and far between. They all died, all of them died, like Sana did. The only thing that changed in the meantime was the breathtaking progress that humanity has made in science and medicine. So even now, this obvious fact illustrates what made me appreciate science more than anything. And to paraphrase Neil deGrasse Tyson, it's true and it works whether you have faith in it or not. So death is incredibly powerful. You know, I would sometimes, as a kid, I would chase ants. The moment they sensed my feet on the ground thumping toward them, they would scurry off in different directions. They knew that death was imminent, and they didn't want to be crushed. And clearly, ants do not possess any subjective awareness or consciousness, nor do they have nociceptors, which are the nerve endings that transmit pain. Yet, they would know each time, definitively, that my shoes would kill them. And they didn't want to die. So this instinct of self-preservation, like the need for us to stay alive, is nearly universal in all living things. So even single-celled bacteria, they avoid damaging environments. They ultimately evolve to adapt to them when needed. As human beings, we're one of the few rare species to not only possess this immensely powerful instinct to survive at any cost, but also the intellectual capacity to fully understand that one day, no matter what, we will die. So this irresolvable conflict gives rise to adaptive defense mechanisms, which help us cope and maintain some sort of psychological stability, homeostasis. And admittedly, it's a strange way to live, to simultaneously harbor both this potent survival instinct and also the certainty of morality, knowledge of the certainty of morality, of mortality, sorry. The idea of necessary permanent death can make life seem really pointless when you look at the big picture, but we don't want that. We don't want life to be pointless. We want our lives to have meaning, and we want justice. Nature is cruel. Storms, hurricanes, famines, earthquakes, tsunamis, they kill millions every year. And they don't just select the assholes to kill, right? They often strike the most vulnerable and the most needy. And pretty much all living things must kill or eat other living things to survive. It's a really cruel system. Competition for territory and resources can be downright deadly. powerful, rich people can commit crime after crime after crime without ever getting caught and die in peace, surrounded by their loved ones, family, and friends. The poor and the downtrodden, on the other hand, are often abused, neglected, and die alone. And children get cancer. So where do you find justice in such a violent, unjust universe? In Yann Martel's classic novel, Life of Pi, has anybody read it or seen the movie? Yeah, so for the rest of you who haven't, I'm about to spoil the ending. The lead character, Pi Patel, argues that a world with God is always a better story than a world without him. So we like good stories. We like stories where good triumphs over evil, where our favorite characters overcome impossible obstacles to survive in the end, where we can stick around to see an ending that answers all of our questions. We like stories where there's some sense of justice, where we know that the inevitable injustices that we suffered in this cruel, stoic universe will not go unchecked, where there's going to be some accountability. But this can't happen if there's no hereafter. So as the great Bertrand Russell wrote in his famous essay, Why I'm Not a Christian, if you're going to have justice in the universe as a whole, you have to suppose a future life to redress the balance of life here on Earth. So they say that there must be a God and there must be heaven and hell in order that in the long run, there may be justice. Now, this isn't something that he believed, obviously. I mean, he thought that this was, quote, a curious argument. And one way that he illustrated the absurdity of it was using the analogy of a crate of oranges. And he said, if you open up the top of it and you find the top layer of oranges to be rotten, they've gone bad, would you assume that the rest of them are okay to eat? No, of course not. You know, you would likely determine that the top layer is rotten, then the rest of them must be rotten too. Yet strangely, we think differently when it comes to justice in the world. We think that because there's so much injustice here, the future world must be just to balance it out. And I learned early on that people like to go with the miraculous, the otherworldly explanation. So as impressive as they might be, pediatric oncologists are still mere mortals. They're fellow human beings, they're right here on Earth. They're destined to suffer the same fate as the rest of us. So we kind of sometimes overlook their achievements because with divine intervention, there's hope. There's hope beyond this life. You know, you can take comfort in the idea that ultimately everything will be fine. Life will be fair. Someone out there is taking care of us. And when your daughter has been ripped out of your arms at age 3, this could well be the only thing that keeps you going. So in contrast to my response to it, Sana's death made her parents even stronger in their faith. And after the I experienced the death of my own father several years ago, I understood this. So when I was planning out my book, where I documented this incident, I sent my aunt the book proposal ahead of time, just to make sure that my memory of this event was accurate. And she's long known that I'm an atheist, but we'd never really discussed the role of that Sana's death had played in my ultimately becoming one. So she said, you know, it's so interesting how the same event can set two people down such different paths. And she understood where I was coming from. But here's the thing, I too understand where she's coming from. I haven't yet mentioned that a year after Sana's death, my aunt and uncle had another daughter who, like her late older sister, developed the same childhood leukemia, also at age 3, and she too did not survive. So this, as you may imagine, or may be unable to imagine, I can't imagine it, was devastating beyond anything that my words today can describe. But it too did not shake their faith. So despite our disagreements, I developed an immense amount of respect for my aunt and my uncle and my cousin, who's her older brother, Sana's older brother. The way that they stuck together and the way they rebuilt their lives after losing two beautiful little girls to merciless disease is nothing short of heroic, in my view. Now, my rational side tells me that just because something gives us comfort doesn't necessarily make it true. That it's important to deal with the realities of the world and the universe as they are. And that rationality and reason are the only paths to discovering any kind of objective truth. And all of that is correct. I think that all of that is true. But if we expect people, especially those who've undergone these kinds of horrific and tragic experiences, to embrace these ideas purely on their merit, we're not just asking them to think differently. We're asking them to let go of their only hope of bringing some kind of justice and meaning to their lives after senseless tragedy. We're asking them to suck it up and accept that the idea, just accept the idea that what happened to them was grossly unfair and unjust, yes, but there's nothing that can be done about it. So the price of letting go can be immensely high. Giving up the security of faith and the idea of an ultimate justice is just one of many costs that an increasing number of Muslims around the world have to pay as they give up the religion of their parents. Recognizing this should help us better understand and empathize with those who are unwilling or unable to leave the comfort of their faith. But here's the thing, and this is really important. It should also help us better appreciate the courage of those who have dared to give it up and construct a new compass for their lives. So in much of the Muslim world where I grew up, religion is more than just a belief system. It's inextricably embedded in every aspect of people's lives. It's a central foundation upon which family, community, morality, they're all built. And probably of most consequence, it's really, really, it's intractably intertwined with one's very sense of identity. And today, as more and more young Muslims give up the religion of their parents, which they are doing, they find themselves facing life-shattering consequences. The simple act of exploring new ideas can leave them isolated from their very own lives. Many are disowned by their parents and lose their families. Their friends refuse to associate with them. Their communities ostracize them. Their societies exile them. Their governments often imprison them, where they can be persecuted, flogged, tortured. And worst of all, there are 13 countries in the world today, all Muslim majority, that punish atheism by death. It's no surprise. A lot of us know this. And as of 2014, Saudi Arabia, again, great Saudi Arabia, has declared all atheists to be terrorists, officially. Atheists are terrorists in Saudi Arabia. But it isn't just the governments. There have been many recent Pew Research polls that have shown that in countries like Pakistan, Egypt, and Malaysia, majorities of the population support the death penalty for apostates. Apostates are people who've left the faith. And in Bangladesh, which is an officially secular country, news stories about atheist bloggers being hacked to death have become disturbingly routine. But it's the personal toll that hits the hardest. So simply changing one's mind can mean leaving behind not only one's family and community, but also childhood memories, lifestyle, relationships, feelings of belonging, and as I mentioned earlier, one sense of security, safety, and comfort. So when beliefs are so deeply ingrained in one's identity, a shattered faith almost inevitably results in a shattered identity, one that must be rebuilt fragment by fragment. This is why they hold on to it so dearly. This is why any attack on the religion, which is not a person, but simply a set of ideas like any other, comes across to them as a personal attack. When you put their beliefs under scrutiny, you're prodding at their entire sense of being. You're rocking the boat, you're criticizing and satirizing that one thing that they need to cling to in order to keep their lives intact, their families together, and in some cases, their heads attached to their bodies. Does this mean you should not criticize or satirize religious beliefs? No, of course not. It's exactly the opposite. It's the only way to break the spell, to borrow from Daniel Dennett. But in order to do it effectively, it's important to first acknowledge what you're dealing with. You can also see how strong this religion identity amalgam is when you look at young ex-Muslims who have recently left the faith. An initial phase of disorientation, anxiety, or depression is very common. My friend, Dr. Simon Cotty from he's at Kent University in the UK, he wrote a book called The Apostates. He wrote about Irtaza Hussein, who was a young 22-year-old man who grew up in a Muslim family in the United Kingdom and ultimately left Islam. His atheism led to a worsening of his already contentious relationship with his father, who first threatened to disown him, but later relented on the condition that the two from then on would not talk about faith. Despite this, Irtaza became more and more despondent until one day his Facebook friends, myself included, saw a picture in our news feeds of him sitting high up in a tree. He had taken the picture himself. Only his legs were visible. The camera was pointing down toward the ground, and there was a light blue rope that was fashioned into a noose. You could see the end of the noose. You could see the rope looping around in the frame of the picture. Hanging from his neck, the caption said, "Just to jump away." And before emergency services could even get to him, he was dead. Irtaza's story isn't unique. In a study of suicide, the French sociologist Emile Durkheim described the phenomenon of anomie, and that's A-N-O-M-I-E, a kind of moral identity crisis that's characterized by instability and the breakdown of social connections between an individual and his or her community. Now, when young Muslims leaving the faith discard their previous moral compass based on Islam, it often leaves a vacuum once they leave it. And it can take some time before they reformulate a renewed sense of identity and connection to their new environment and milieu. So those who do find a community of like-minded peers seem to fare better. I once attended a party on Eid, and Eid is a Muslim holiday. It's like the Muslim Christmas in a way. It was thrown by young ex-Muslims who had been estranged from their families. Their parents had disowned them and so on. None of them wanted to be alone on Eid, which made them feel the absence of their loved ones even more. So they decided to spend it with each other. It was clear at the party that many of them were in transition and acting out. The strict religious rules dealing with diet and conduct that had bound them in their old lives were being flouted aggressively. There was bacon on virtually every dinner item, for one. There were large amounts of alcohol that were being consumed without restraint. There were two young women who had been wearing the hijab since childhood, the hijab, the head covering. And today they were wearing revealing clothing and heavy makeup, and they flirted unabashedly with the men at the party and with each other. So the pendulum had swung the other way. And as pronounced as it was in some cases, I found it to be healthy. This group of young men and women had established a community for themselves that was like-minded with similar experiences. They were battling their inhibitions. They were experimenting without fear of judgment or penalty. The men were making conscious, deliberate efforts to be tolerant of and to appreciate what they'd always been taught to view with disdain. The women, who had been raised to erase any semblance of sexuality from their parents, were now exploring it without reservation or reticence. Ultimately, many of them would find equilibrium and stability, and they'd learn to define themselves in a new way. Others, like Irtaza, aren't as fortunate. I want to remind you that these monumental upheavals in the lives of young, free-thinking Muslims are solely the consequence of changing their minds about one thing, their religion. This is the price that they have to pay. And we should always be mindful of this. One of the ugliest and most sinister aspects of any religion, actually, is this intricate entanglement of ideology and identity, and the often dire consequences for those who have the ability and the courage to pry the two apart. Imagine If simply changing your mind came with that kind of cost, how willing would you be to do it? Now, what is it then that has empowered more ex-Muslims to start speaking out publicly in a way that they've otherwise never done? What are some of the factors that can help lower this cost of letting go? Maryam Namazi, how many of you have heard of Maryam Namazi? I think everybody knows her. She's an Iranian-born feminist and human rights activist who started the Council of Ex-Muslims of Britain, or CEMB, in 2007. You see, the members of this group have now grown from just a handful when it started to thousands today, not only in Britain, but also across the rest of the world. And there are similar organizations that have also cropped up in other countries, including two major ones in North America. There's Muslimish. It's called Muslimish. It's a great organization. I went to their conference last month, and it was fantastic. It was in New York City, where liberal and questioning Muslims can actually interact with ex-Muslims securely. And then there's Ex-Muslims of North America, which many of you have probably heard of as well. So these organizations provide secure forums for ex-Muslims to connect, share their stories, and discuss ideas. They enable agnostics and atheists from Muslim backgrounds to find others like themselves in their own towns and cities and speak face-to-face with one another, either in person or during or online through platforms like Google Hangouts and Skype and so on. Now, all of these groups are stringent about maintaining security for their members. They're careful to vet their members thoroughly when they join, and they take great care to prevent any circumstance that leads to the outing of their closeted members, particularly those that live in Muslim-majority countries. So in preparation for International Human Rights Day last year, which was in December, Maryam and CEMB began a campaign inviting ex-Muslims from around the world to use photographs, videos, and handwritten signs to explain why they left Islam. The movement was named Ex-Muslim Because, hashtag Ex-Muslim Because, and it was spearheaded by my friend Rehana Sultan, who's a CEMB member of Bangladeshi origin. And although the campaign was announced several weeks before International Human Rights Day, the response was immediate and tremendous. Within 24 hours, Ex-Muslim Because became the number one trending hashtag on Twitter in the United Kingdom. Close to 20,000 people participated in just the first day, going up to hundreds of thousands in the first week. There were tweets from secret LGBT Saudis, women who had been forced into marriages, closeted atheists in Egypt and Pakistan, tweeting under pseudonyms, young women disowned by their families in the United States, and more. So I covered the campaign for the Huffington Post, and I compiled some of the most popular tweets as the hashtag went viral. Here's what I wrote as an introduction. Just doing a quick Marco Rubio there. What you'll see below is the often unheard third side to the international conversation we have been witnessing since the Paris attacks, a conversation that represents an increasingly reverberating alternative narrative that is developing across the Muslim world, where atheism is on the rise. These messages should be read by everyone who wants to understand narratives in the Muslim world, otherwise all too often silenced before reaching us. And I also included three important points to consider as readers read through the tweets. The first one: being part of Muslim families and communities, ex-Muslims not only receive the same bigoted treatment, sometimes directed at other Muslims, but are also persecuted, often severely, by Muslims who consider them heretics and apostates. This is they're a minority within a minority. And this is a significant factor that distinguishes ex-Muslim critics of Islam and far-right Western critics of Islam. And this is the conflation of ideas and people. Most ex-Muslims have Muslim-sounding names, like myself, and have lived in and come from the same places as their Muslim counterparts, as I have. So consequently, they're just as likely as other Muslims to be on the receiving end of anti-Muslim sentiment and or harassment. So people like myself or Faisal Matar or even Ayaan Hirsi Ali, these are when for example, when Donald Trump says that he's going to ban Muslim immigration, these are also the people that would never make it here, because for them, like, we're all considered to be part of that. There's no other vetting. There's no way that you can really test somebody for whether they actually believe or not. So that's important to keep in mind. The second point I made was this. Ex-Muslims often find themselves caught between the anti-Muslim bigotry of the far right that demonizes all Muslims and the apologism of the far left that conflates any legitimate criticism of Islam with bigotry or Islamophobia. Criticizing Islam and demonizing Muslims are very different things. And so many ex-Muslims do have lifelong Muslim friends and family who are supportive, even if they disagree. This was a common theme in the ex-Muslim because tweets. And many of the participants, while they were certainly unreserved in the criticism of the faith, they made it a point to differentiate between criticizing Islam, which is an idea, and demonizing Muslims, which are people. Human beings have rights and are entitled to respect. Ideas, books, and beliefs don't and aren't. Third point, many ex-Muslims feel betrayed by their liberal counterparts in the West. The fight against Islamic Jihad should come from a position of moral strength, not xenophobic bigotry. This is a fight that liberals should take on themselves before it's hijacked by the far right. We're already seeing this happen. So this is a crucial point. In countries where Muslims are a minority, Islam is an identity. In countries where Muslims are a majority, Islam is a religion. This dichotomy has consequences for liberals on either side. So for the liberal in North America, Islam is the faith of a small minority of Muslims who are often discriminated against and whose rights must be protected, as with any minority group. I mean, this is part of the liberal conscience to protect the rights of minorities. But for the liberal in a Muslim majority country, Islam is a tool that the government uses to justify censorship, oppression, and other illiberal values, like forcing women to wear the hijab, persecuting homosexuals, and publicly lashing bloggers. So the same holy book that Muslims in the United States and elsewhere revere as divine and peaceful, over there is used by governments of Muslim-majority countries to endorse everything from domestic violence to the execution of apostates. The hijab, worn proudly by Muslim American women who choose it as a symbol of their identity, over there is forced on women in those Muslim majority countries by their governments, imams, or husbands. And of course, many criticisms of Islamic doctrine made by liberal reformers and dissidents in Muslim majority countries, when they come here, they become labeled Islamophobic or bigoted. So it's easy to see how this can get really confusing really fast. So it's a well-intentioned effort. So in their well-intentioned effort to protect what they see as a targeted minority, Western liberals unwittingly find themselves fighting to guard and protect the same backward values that their counterparts, their liberal counterparts in Muslim majority countries are fighting against. So my friend Faisal Saeed Al-Matar, who many of you know, and he's coming to speak here in October. He's an Iraqi refugee. He's a writer and a human rights activist. He puts it best. He says, many Western liberals have betrayed us liberals in the Middle East and other Muslim countries and sided with the Islamists against us. Now, this sounds blunt, but this is really what it feels like, the people over there. It's a common sentiment among liberals in the Arab and Muslim world, and it's understandable to see why. So it's as if the same idea is bad if a KKK member says it, or if it appears in the Tea Party manifesto, but it's perfectly fine when it appears in a certain holy book. Then you just back off and say, well, you know, we got to respect this, someone's belief. So when liberals equate criticizing Islamic doctrine with anti-Muslim bigotry, and when they go out of their way to avoid criticizing Islam, it leaves a vacuum that is frequently filled by genuine right-wing anti-Muslim bigots who are even more disagreeable. Who gets stuck in the middle? ex-Muslims. So Maryam Namazi, she herself stated during the campaign that she was not angry with Muslims. Quote, she said, "My family are Muslims and very supportive of me. Criticizing Islam and Islamism is not anti-Muslim." And this is sort of like, we're familiar with this concept. It's the quote that Voltaire never really said, misattributed to him, was that, "I may despise what you say, but I will defend to the death your right to say it." So this is not a contradictory thing. It's a concept that's been around for a long time. Anyway, so I'll get to the tweets. These are some of the most widely circulated ones. Let's just get to it. This is Aina. Many of you know her too. She's ex-Muslim because I know being a woman doesn't make me lesser. I shouldn't have to worship behind men or be segregated from them. That's me. No real God should need protection from bloggers, and no real prophet should need protection from cartoons. Ex-Muslim because I'd be sentenced to death if I was outed as an apostate in Saudi Arabia. And this is from someone who was in Saudi Arabia. Ex-Muslim because I am not an abomination by virtue of being gay. And these are the tweets that actually led this hashtag to go viral and become the top trending hashtag in the UK. Ex-Muslim because atheist bloggers are being killed in my country, Bangladesh, but my Muslim friends are directly or indirectly supporting it. Ex-Muslim because my own mother told me I should be killed because I didn't believe the same thing she did. Ex-Muslim because I'm told Islam gives you freedom of thought and religion, but at the same time punishes apostasy by death. Ex-Muslim because for some reason Islam bans alcohol and premarital sex, but not slavery. And it's not just Islam. This is like one of the most astounding things about organized religion in general. Ex-Muslim because I care about what is true. Ex-Muslim because I was tired of trying to fit inside a box that was never made for me. Ex-Muslim because I prefer reality over myth and reason over ignorance. Ex-Muslim because LGBT are humans and not my enemies. Ex-Muslim because I'd rather look through a telescope than read a book that says I came out of a man's rib to be lured by a talking snake. Yeah. Ex-Muslim because I didn't want to live in guilt anymore. Ex-Muslim because speaking my truth should not be a death sentence. Ex-Muslim because I am a Saudi, enough said. And then this was the ex-Muslims forum, this is a CEMB forum. They said this was sent to them anonymously by an ex-Muslim woman who was afraid to speak up openly. And she writes, ex-Muslim because my dad, the Sheikh, said there's no such thing as rape in marriage in Islam, you're a liar. When I'd asked him to tell the man he'd married me off to at 17 to stop raping me, my own dad. And then this was, you know, obviously, it was a very popular food among the ex-Muslim crowd. And so maybe, I think there's a comedian that said that a lot of people don't eat bacon they don't do bacon for religious reasons, and I don't do religion for bacon reasons. So I can't remember the name of the comedian, but. In any case, So this is a powerful revelatory campaign. It wasn't without its expected backlash. Most Muslims didn't seem to be aware that ex-Muslims were now significant enough in number to drive this hashtag up to the top trending spot. And upon seeing it, some were very angry. They called the campaign hateful and untimely, considering it launched within a week of the November 2015 Paris attacks. And they said, you know, Muslims are under target right now. They're at increased risk of harassment and even hate crimes. And why are you guys doing this? And I think these critics are misguided. I mean, I don't want to diminish the very real problem of anti-Muslim bigotry, which I'm making a point to highlight here. But it only seems to be with Islam that whenever dozens of largely non-Muslim innocents are mercilessly murdered by Muslim men yelling Allahu Akbar, the attention in the aftermath somehow immediately turns to the victimization of Muslims. I get why this is, but I would say that one of the things that turned me off from Islam and religion in general is the trend that after almost every terrorist attack carried out in the name of Islam, the first reaction of some apologists is, oh no, I hope this doesn't make Islam look bad. And soon after that, we're treated to that inevitable, increasingly cliched, you know, the unconvincing statements that, you know, come out of pretty much everybody, like Islam is a religion of peace or terrorists have no religion, you know, which isn't true. Is you know, Einstein and Stephen Hawking and Bertrand Russell don't have a religion. I mean, those are the people who don't. Like, terrorism almost definitely has a religion. And then these are statements that don't really resonate now, too far beyond the confines of a steadily shrinking echo chamber. I've always seen this as a seriously disordered sense of prioritization that, whether it's well-intentioned or not, ends up valuing ideology over human beings. So the Ex-Muslim campaign, Ex-Muslim Because campaign, was avidly backed by Richard Dawkins, who's the, you know, evolutionary biologist, atheist activist, and he's often accused of racism, you know, despite being an ardent supporter of thousands upon thousands of non-white ex-Muslims. He frequently comes under fire for his like strident tone and, you know, his approach to criticizing religion by many in the West, including some ex-Muslims themselves. But to thousands of closeted ex-Muslims actually living in the Muslim world that I've corresponded with over the last 7 to 8 years, he's widely regarded as a hero. And this is something I have always found interesting. Like, that aggressive, upfront approach, the angry approach to criticizing and attacking religion by people like Richard Dawkins or by people like Christopher Hitchens seem somehow relatable and resonate with closeted ex-Muslims or atheists and agnostics in Muslim-majority countries. Now, remember, these are people who they're unable to openly speak out about the abuse and oppression that they've suffered at the hands of their governments, their communities, and even their families in the name of the religion. So they're angry. And they often view these sort of the conciliatory and the respectful attitudes that we have towards oppressive religious theology as a luxury that's affordable only to those privileged enough to live in open societies. They respect people like Richard Dawkins for breaking with many of his fellow liberals in the West to take up the cause of real liberals around the world who are doing the heavy lifting where it really matters. So as expected, Dawkins was flabbergasted at the backlash to the CEMB's campaign. And he tweeted this, he said, people are saying ex-Muslim because is hateful. How can telling people why you left a religion be hate? By what bizarrely twisted logic? It's hard to argue against that. So he urged ex-Muslims around the world to continue to use the hashtag and to share their stories. So overall, there are several factors that help lower the cost of letting go. The supportive parents, quality education, and so on. But being part of a robust, thriving community of like-minded peers, in my experience at least, is the single most important factor that helps young Muslims make that leap from religion to rationality. And giving that community a voice and a platform via the internet and social media can empower them immeasurably. So over two-thirds of the populations in countries like Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Egypt are under the age of 35. To these young people who have grown up under monarchs and dictators for decades, they've never seen anything else. For them, freedom of speech is often a completely alien concept. For them, social media platforms like Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter, they aren't just an entertaining extension of their real lives as they are to many of us. They're a fantastical ingress into reality. They're virtual vessels into the real world, where you can say what you can't in real life. And you can be exposed to the uncensored ideas of people around the world, where you can talk to them, even watch them. These forums represent an unprecedented portal into a world most of them never knew existed as little as 10 years ago. One that allows them to live inside the outside world. And we hear every day about the steadily widening income inequality gap. But when it comes to the more vaguely defined opportunity gap, the story is significantly different. Of course, economics has a considerable influence on access to opportunity in the conventional sense, that's true. But the role that technology plays, in this can't be understated. So as a, when I was younger and when I was growing up in Pakistan, I used to play in a rock band. And that's why I wore my Nikki Six shirt here. Nikki Six and Motley Crue, loved them. I was coming to Los Angeles, Hollywood, and I was like, I'm gonna wear that. Take off my sunglasses here. I keep bumping into them. So I remember what it took for my band in Pakistan to record and distribute a decent demo in the early to mid 1990s. We would cobble together whatever meager resources we had to be able to afford a shift or two in an average recording studio. It was very expensive. We used to be billed at an hourly rate. Our performances had to be thoroughly well rehearsed. There's no auto-tune or pitch correction. Yes. Time was short, pressure was high. Mastering usually cost extra, and the final recording quality was rarely good enough to compete with anything mainstream. Once we had our master tape, we would spend days making copies of it ourselves and just dubbing tape to tape, or you know, later when CDs came around, it was a little easier, but just a little. Then we would physically have to go out and distribute these tapes or CDs and at shows and other places, and we'd have to send them off by snail mail to local labels hoping to get signed. Music videos were out of the question. But today, any talented teenager in Sierra Leone can make a broadcast quality recording on their smartphone and upload it as an MP3. They can shoot a high definition music video also on their smartphone and upload it to YouTube. They can distribute it worldwide for next to nothing. They can promote it using social media, and they can even make money from it. Now, of course, there's still many obstacles in the way, but this is a tremendous opportunity that was available only to the privileged and lucky people in the past. But now it's available to almost anyone. And one of the most interesting aspects of Steve Jobs' biography relates to his pilgrimage to India in the 1970s. Now, he intended it to be a spiritual exploration in accordance with the teachings of one of his favorite gurus, the world-famous Neem Karoli Baba. Unfortunately, the guru died shortly before Jobs could meet him, but Jobs stayed on. He stayed in India, he lived on a potato farm, traveled around the country. He was deeply impacted by the immense poverty that he saw, the suffering of the people in India. But apart from a little dollop of Buddhism, which he brought back with him, his love affair with India didn't last long. And the insight he gained from it was invaluable and unexpected. And he told his biographer, and I quote, "It was one of the first times I started thinking that maybe Thomas Edison did a lot more to improve the world than Karl Marx and Neem Karoli Baba combined." So I sometimes feel as if we're living in an almost post-imperial world. So the far-left rhetoric against corporatocracy and corporations and so on that I grew up with in the late 20th century seems almost like a blur today. YouTube is full of videos uploaded by ordinary civilians from Gaza, showing us a side of the Israeli-Palestinian war we never really saw before the advent of streaming video. The 2009 Green Revolution in Iran, I mean, you guys remember that when they're going up against the election of Ahmadinejad, the re-election of him, allowed us a rare glimpse into the country's hidden society post-revolution that we hadn't really seen before. Courtesy of brave Iranian activists on Twitter. And Wael Ghanim was the Egyptian activist who started the 2011 Tahrir Square protests in Cairo that ultimately took down Hosni Mubarak during the Arab Spring after 30 years of dictatorial rule. Did so with the help of Facebook. And so some of you know that I was banned from Facebook for the last 24 hours, so I don't love them right now, but we'll get to that later. So shortly after Mubarak stepped down, Wael Ghanim told CNN that he wanted to meet Mark Zuckerberg in person to thank him. And he said, quote, "This revolution started online. This revolution started on Facebook. I've always said that if you want to liberate a society, just give them the internet." Now think about that for a minute. Facebook is a US corporation headed by a young Jewish atheist who started it in his Harvard dorm room, I think when he was 19. It has in its possession private information on over a billion people, not just their names and their contact information and their geographic locations, but also their personal preferences, their likes, their dislikes, you know, whether they're upset about a breakup or, you know, all kinds of things. And it sells all this information to advertisers. It makes them available to advertisers. Now, to protesters in the 1980s, this would sound like an Orwellian nightmare, right? But to Egyptians in 2011, this was an instrument of revolutionary change. Google, Twitter, Apple, and other tech giants are part of the same dynamic. Like, it's a strange time right now that we're with social media and the huge corporations that are actually running it and facilitating it all. Social change is now profitable to many of the world's largest corporations. Positive social change. And their goals are aligned. So we're living in an age where anti-capitalists, Occupy Wall Street activists, use their iPhones to film their protests. They're fueled by morning caffeine rushes, courtesy of Starbucks. Innovation is crowdsourced with services like Kickstarter. Regular folk are empowered by Uber and Airbnb at the expense of long-established transportation and hotel industry giants. So this is a world where regular individuals with an internet connection can change the course of history. The cables released by Julian Assange's WikiLeaks helped trigger the Tunisian Jasmine Revolution that led to the ouster of its dictator, Ben Ali, which was the first domino to fall in the Arab Spring. And then the Libyan dictator, Muammar Gaddafi, angrily called out WikiLeaks in a speech that he made. And he was right to be anxious because a few months later, he saw his own 42-year rule come to a brutal end along with his life. Well, as you know, I think Julian Assange and WikiLeaks is having an effect on the Democratic National Convention starting tomorrow too. So he's still at it. But unlike anything revolutionary, the technology age is it's a double-edged sword. There's two sides to it. And terrorism has also come of age with the millennial generation. The Islamic State of today is miles ahead of the Al-Qaeda that it grew out of. Its members aren't coming from Afghanistan, Iraq, or Pakistan anymore. They're living in Belgium, France, Britain, and even the United States. They're not refugees or illegal immigrants. Most of them aren't, actually. They're legal, passport-carrying, Western-born or naturalized citizens of the countries that we live in. So what does bombing them do now? You know, ISIS isn't a geographical entity. You know, there are kids sitting right across Western countries, like right where we are, across the entire country here, in our cities, in our neighborhoods, you know, being inspired and groomed by the group's wide-ranging social media expertise and slickly produced propaganda videos as we speak. These kids are not coming here from Syria. They've always been here. But not everybody's joining up. The success of a campaign like Ex-Muslim Because, the burgeoning memberships of ex-Muslim groups like CEMB, Muslimish, and ex-MNA, and the steadily growing audiences of dissidents like Somali-born ex-Muslim feminist activist Ayaan Hirsi Ali, who many of you know, and reformers like Majid Nawaz, show that there's something else brewing too. Something that you don't hear about as much because it's historically been suppressed by governments, moderates, and fundamentalists alike. It can be seen, you can see that from their tweets and more, many young Muslims are reacting to this suppression. They're watching the Islamic State's antics around the world and they're seeing how it makes them look. They're studying the scriptures that their parents taught them, that their parents taught them was infallible. And they're dealing with high levels of unemployment and economic difficulty due to their government's corrupt and ineffectual policies. They're watching their leaders use religion and blasphemy laws to solidify their authority and restrict the freedoms of their people. This worked in the past, but not anymore. On websites like WikiLeaks, they learn things about their governments and the world that they have never seen in their newspapers. They discover the roles that their own leaders have played in bringing about the frustrations and difficult conditions that they were told were the fault of the United States and Israel. They speak to their online friends who are living in open societies, who tell them of free speech, gender equality, LGBT rights. It's like someone who's been locked in a dark room since birth, suddenly gaining access to a window and looking outside for the first time and realizing that they're not the only ones locked in. So think about what they're struggling for: secularism, justice, equality, the right to elect their own leaders, the right to speak freely. And think about what they're willing to risk: isolation, imprisonment, torture, or even death. All just to fight for the same things that the rest of us take for granted every day. So I'll close here with a passage from an article by Thomas Friedman in the New York Times, which is entitled "How ISIS Drives Muslims from Islam," where he writes about how he is seeing more and more Muslims letting go. And I thought this quote really summed up well what I was trying to get at. So he writes, "There is a significant group of Muslims who feel that their government-backed preachers and religious hierarchies have handed them a brand of Islam that does not speak to them. These same authorities have also denied them the critical thinking tools and religious space to imagine new interpretations. And some seem to be quietly detaching from religion entirely, fed up with being patronized by politically correct Westerners telling them what Islam is and telling them what Islam is not, and with being tyrannized by self-appointed Islamist authoritarians telling them what Islam is. Now that the internet has created free, safe, alternative spaces and platforms to discuss these issues outside the mosques and government-owned media, this war of ideas is on." Amen. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And this more, this is my book. It's called The Atheist Muslim, A Journey from Religion to Reason. I know that many of you will think this is an oxymoron. How can you be an atheist? The whole idea is, and you know, you read the book and find out why it's called that. You can. Yeah. So there you go.
So my question very simply is it true that either you are a practicing, believing Muslim, or you're not, and nothing in between?
So yeah, that's a good question, and you'll see that a lot of people in the Muslim world themselves are fighting over it. Everybody that over here says that ISIS aren't true Muslims. That's exactly what ISIS says about everybody here. And you know, the Sunnis think that the Shias aren't, many Sunnis think that Shias aren't true Muslims. Many Shias think that the Ahmadis are not true Muslims. And you know, it just keeps going. Eventually, in that way, there are no Muslims that exist anywhere. And this is one of the sort of, the title of this book is actually tongue in cheek. And this is kind of what I was getting at, is how narrow these labels are. So 1400 years ago, the word Muslim meant that you were a follower of Islam. You know, Muhammad was right there. And if he wasn't right there, he'd just been here a couple of hundred years ago, and you followed the religion to a T. Right. Now the word Muslim, there are 1.6 billion Muslims in the world. The Quran is in Arabic. The majority of these Muslims, if you look at the biggest Muslim populations in the world, it's Indonesia, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Iran, Turkey. These are not Arabic-speaking countries. The vast majority of Muslims in the world don't even speak Arabic, so they can't even understand what's in the Quran. So now what you have is, and this is one of the reasons I try to make the distinction between Islam as defined by the content of the canonical texts of the Quran and Hadiths, and Muslims, which is a really diverse community that's not monolithic. And there are a lot of cultural elements that have come into it too. So many people who are just born into a Muslim family now just adopt it as a birth identity. So practically speaking today, you know, the word Muslim doesn't necessarily mean someone who believes in Islam. There is precedent for this. So I would say that the Jewish religion, in a lot of ways, Judaism, the religion itself, not the community, is very similar to Islam. I kind of say that if Moses hadn't hallucinated up Judaism, then Muhammad wouldn't have been able to plagiarize it. But it's very simple. You have you know, first of all, both of the prophets can be nicknamed Mo. That's one thing. There's salam in among Muslims, there's shalom for Jews, religious Jews. You know, there's no foreskins anywhere. You don't see any foreskins yet. Abraham liked dickheads. The other, there's a lot of these similarities that you see, the pork issue. And I've always found that entertaining as well because, you know, Abraham has ham in it. Muhammad has ham in it. Jesus spelled backwards sounds like sausage. It's like, it is sausage. So I've never understood that hostility. But there are a lot of these common elements. But the important thing, like aside from all this, I digressed a bit, is that for the longest time in Judaism, Moses was thought to have gotten the direct word of God and Mount Sinai and the tabernacle. Right. So this was something that religious Jews for a very, very long time, and most of them were religious at a certain time, they actually believed was the literal word of God, as Muslims believe the Quran, most of them believe the Quran to be today. And it was with the advent of, obviously there's many things that happened in Jewish history that changed that today the majority of, or plurality of American Muslims, about 35% American Jews, approximately 35% of them are Reformed Jews. And Reformed Jews, you know, they don't believe the Torah to be the word of God. They actually believe it to be the work of human hands. So that's a precedent that has happened. And it happened because, you know, these religions, these other Abrahamic religions were actually forced to, like this, a friend of mine who goes by the pseudonym Re-Enlightenment, he says that they were forced through the grinder of secularism and the Enlightenment. And they came out the other end as a sort of dismembered, you know, more dilute version of what they used to be.
Yeah, this is very basically Christianity in Europe 500 years ago had a reformation
right. That
really changed everything.
It did, and a lot of people...
And I don't see that Islam has had a reformation.
I think, yeah. Oh, so I actually think that it can happen, and I think that the first step to that is to reject scriptural inerrancy. And that's what I was getting at. That's one thing that Judaism and Christianity have been able to do over the years. The Reformation was instrumental in that. Many people think that it was necessary for the Enlightenment to occur later. Some people think that they were unconnected, but I actually think it was necessary, even though it was really, really violent and so on. It took a lot of bloodshed to get there. And that led to the idea, or to people exploring the idea that, okay, this scripture, maybe it's not inerrant. Maybe it's not the literal word of God. And there are many Muslims today who are saying that, like reformists like Majid Nawaz or people like Asr Nomani, and a lot of them who you prominently see on TV, especially here in North America. None of them say that the Quran is an inerrant book anymore, and they're committed Muslims as well. So I think that the label, the word Muslim itself, doesn't have the same meaning that it did before someone who believes in Islam. The word Christian, if you define a Christian as someone who believes in the Bible, word for word, you don't see a lot of Christians going around telling women to shut up in church or, you know, killing people who work on the, or Jews killing people on the Sabbath and, you know, who work on the Sabbath and so on. So I think that there's Islam, which is defined by the canonical texts, and I think there are Muslims, which is a community that is defined largely as a birth identity, people who are just born into it and really don't know that much about it. So, and I think we'll see it change a lot, and I'm seeing it already. I mean, we're a long way from the Salman Rushdie days, right?
I was wondering if you could give me an idea of the rate of increase of atheism in the Islamic community over time.
Well, over time, one thing that we're seeing with the polls, and when you look at polls, it is increasing. But that is probably, I don't think there's any way to know the real number, which I would assume is much, much higher. Because, as you know, the people who, I'll put it this way, I mean, even if you have religious people who question something, like Malala Yousafzai, a 14-year-old girl, she is a Muslim. She just questioned the idea that, you know, that she wanted girls to be able to go to school. They shot her in the head. Raif Badawi started a secular website just talking about secularism, and secularism as in separation of religion and state, not anti-religion, just separation of the two. In Saudi Arabia, he's in jail right now, still. 10-year sentence, you know, he's a sentence of 1,000 lashings or floggings. So there are most of these people that even if they do think, if they are leaning towards agnosticism or atheism or secularism even, they won't speak out. You won't hear from them. The ones that do speak out have largely done so as they came here. Like, I'm doing this talk over here. I never really talked about this. I came to North America when I was 24. Before this, I never really openly talked about it. Ayan Hirsi Ali is another one. Faisal Al-Muttar, who was a really good friend of mine, started the global secular humanist movement when he was a kid. He was also a correspondent for Christopher Hitchens when he was in northern Iraq at the time. And the moment he started it, his brother died. Al-Qaeda killed his brother. A friend of his was killed. He was on the run. He was living in Lebanon and Malaysia, all these places, before he got asylum in the U.S. In 2013. So, you know, everybody there knows about this. They know that, you know, you speak too much. This is what happens. So I would, whatever numbers that you're seeing right now, even this stuff with ex-Muslim because, I mean, these are the people on Twitter, these numbers, which are in the hundreds of thousands, are probably a gross, gross underestimation of the actual number of people in the Muslim world who are thinking this way now, especially in the internet age.
This is just kind of an inquiry, but I was about 2 decades ago, I went to Saudi Arabia to teach for about 2 weeks. And my visa said that I was a Christian because it was filled out by my company. They didn't ask me. They just assumed. So I got into Saudi Arabia under a Christian visa, and I was teaching, and my students finally said something to me about being a Christian. And then at that point in time, I told them, no, I'm not a Christian. I'm an atheist.
Where were you? What city?
Riyadh.
Oh, you were in Riyadh. Okay. Yeah.
So about a week later, I was talking to some of my students, and they let me know that there was a pretty significant underground in Saudi Arabia, that there were parties with alcohol, there were parties behind closed doors, where women were wearing Western clothing, and the sexes mixed together. Mm-hmm. And they let me know that if I was there, I was only there for 2 weeks, but if I would have been there for longer, they could have eventually have gotten me into some of the parties. So I kind of related it a little bit to the marijuana community in the United States. Officially, marijuana is illegal, but I think everybody pretty much knows there's a significant marijuana community here. Mm-hmm. So it seemed to me it was the same thing. So one of the questions, it's actually 2 questions quickly, but one of them is, of course, I had no feeling for how significant that underground was. Mm-hmm. And I'm under the impression now, just by watching the news, that I think there's a crackdown going on it in Saudi Arabia. So that's my 2 questions for you.
Well, I think you're right. I mean, that's one of the reasons that I mentioned here in my talk that Saudi Arabia has declared all atheists to be terrorists. And that's really a reaction that didn't come out of nowhere. You know, they didn't just decide one day that, okay, we're going to call all atheists terrorists. They haven't done that for the longest time. But they specifically made that law because they know that there's a lot of this going around in those countries. They know that there's a burgeoning atheist community. I'm in correspondence with a lot of atheists from Saudi Arabia. There was actually a Pew poll that showed that up to 5 or 6% of Saudis are committed atheists, not agnostic, not anything, just committed atheists. And 5% is a huge number in Saudi Arabia. And to think that these are the people who actually just reported it on the polls, and who knows how many others there are. So you're right. I think the marijuana smoker analogy is accurate, except that if they actually get caught there, they'll get beheaded. They'll be, you know, they'll be put in jail. They'll be flogged, whatever it is, or they will... I mean, Saudi Arabia, let me put it in context. In August 2014, when James Foley was, James Foley, the journalist, was beheaded by ISIS, and the entire world was reeling in shock, Saudi Arabia, which is a very close U.S. ally, officially the government beheaded 19 people. And the crimes weren't just murder. They were sorcery was one of the crimes that someone was beheaded for. This drug smuggling or, you know, drug use, even including marijuana. People can be killed for using marijuana there. So that, I think, is a stark difference. I mean, over here, if they bust one of these underground groups who are smoking pot, they're not going to be executed for it. So, yeah, it is. I think it's growing a lot from what I'm seeing. Again, you know, as we said before, I just don't think we have any numbers that are accurate, and any numbers that you do see or hear about are probably a gross underestimation.
Oh, sorry. Hi.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Yes. My father grew up in Texas, the son of a very prominent judge, and he was a lifelong closet atheist.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering, would you say that in Muslim countries for a long time there have been any closet atheists or a substantial number, or is this a relatively recent development?
I think they've been around for the longest time. And if you look at, if you just look at the literary history of writers in the Muslim, then many of them were actually open. I mean, the society was much more open for a certain period of time, and people used to have these discussions very commonly. And you know, there was a group called the Mu'tazilites that was just a few hundred years after Muhammad's death, and they openly questioned the inerrancy of the Quran. They weren't necessarily atheist, but they were open about their beliefs, like beliefs that today would get them killed. So historically, there have been many groups. I think recently what's happened is that the punishment for them is stricter. There has been a resurgence of fundamentalism. I think a lot of it happened in the 1970s. There were like sort of three major things that happened during then. One is that Saudi Arabia got very rich. Oil money, Saudi Arabia got hugely rich, and they follow the Salafist or the Wahhabi ideology, which is extremely fundamentalist, and it wants to revive Islam in the form that it was during the first three generations of the time of Muhammad, the way that it was practiced then, or the way that they think it was practiced then. So you had that, and suddenly that ideology had a huge amount of oil money behind it, and they started funding schools all over the world, notably in Pakistan and Afghanistan, and that's where the second thing was going on, which is the U.S. was gearing up for its war with the Soviet Union in Afghanistan. And at that point, you guys, any of you remember the Mujahideen and how there were heroes at the time, right? Jihad was, and the word Mujahideen comes from jihad. So it's basically people who are jihadists, the word for jihadists, and the U.S. considered them heroes at the time. So that was another thing. The U.S. had a lot of it actually backed this as well. All of these madrasas were opening up to train soldiers to go into Afghanistan to fight. So all these little kids were getting educations funded by Saudi Arabia's new oil-rich money to get educated in Pakistan, then go into Afghanistan and fight. And these, the word for these students in Urdu and in Pashto, is Taliban. Like, Talib means student. Taliban is plural for students. That's where they came from. So there was a lot of money that actually went behind this super fundamentalist ideology that started in the 70s. In the 70s, you also had in the Shia land, you had Khomeini in Iran come to power. So it was basically just a cluster. Okay, well, you know what I mean. But yeah, it was just a whole bunch of things happening then, and we're kind of seeing the effects of it today. So yes, there is a doctrinal, you know, element to it that's been around throughout. But I think that more people have gone into the closet, less people speak openly about it now, or especially since there's been this resurgence, and the consequences of it are worse. And the dictators in the Middle East, they've always had this, they use religion very effectively, in the sense that most of them are secular, like Saddam Hussein was very secular, Bashar al-Assad was secular, so on. But they play this balancing game, is they use it just enough to be able to scare their people into submission. But at the same time, if anybody's beard gets too long or anybody's voice gets too loud at the Friday sermon at the mosque, they get whisked away in the middle of the night and you never hear from them again. So that's also another reason that there has been a resurgence, and they've kind of, Islam is, is a religion that's actually particularly susceptible to being used by politicians for good reason. You know, that's not a defense of Islam, it's actually a further incrimination of it. So.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I am a humanist, a universalist, and a Muslim. Uh-huh. I work to disrupt received theology. Mm-hmm. Disrupting received theology. That is where we take the context to the tradition and mm-hmm. see if it is applicable. And if not, we leave the tradition. And it's a hard, hard journey to do that. Because even as we are gathered here today, let us not forget, in thousands of churches, people are planning how to feed the poor, how to start a nonprofit, how to take water to Africa. Mm-hmm. Good things do happen in religious communities because they are the most organized communities. So my question to you is, can we not say either this or that? Can we tread a middle path where we can come together to disrupt the received theology?
Sorry, can you disrupt the what?
Received theology. Received theology. So that we can examine the context. Mm-hmm. And then, if the tradition does not fit the context, we have to leave the tradition. And that's what you're saying too. Mm-hmm. But we are having a line between us.
Yeah.
So how can we come together and explore this? Because there are 1.8 billion Muslims. And I come from Sri Lanka. Mm-hmm. Where we learned a different kind of Islam. And only 15% of the Muslims are from Middle East. And the whole world looks at the Muslims through their lens of the Middle East. Mm-hmm. And I have issue, like you, with the received theology. Mm-hmm. And my work is centered around disrupting that. And I have been ostracized, I have been marginalized, I have been sidelined, and I have experienced everything that you're saying. Mm-hmm. Just as much as for me to stay strong, I need your voice. This is not even a question, this is to express solidarity with you. But again, how can we celebrate our humanity at the same time?
And the solidarity goes right back to you. I mean, what you're talking about is some of the conversations that I've had with like my Majid Nawaz and other friends of mine who feel the same way. And, you know, they are doing good things. They're believing Muslims. They challenge the received theology. They like to talk about it in the context. And when it comes to our goals and what we want to do, we're completely aligned. I mean, like, these are people I'm very good friends with. I, you know, completely see where they're coming from. We diverge on certain things, like, you know, for instance, on the theology aspect. Like, I reject it completely for certain reasons. I think that some things, you know, when you talk about context, there are some things I don't think are okay in any context. So I think that when we take something like the Quran, we assume, we have a sort of preconceived conclusion that this has to be correct because it's the word of God. And then we find ways to sort of justify it and, you know, twist it in a way that it suits our morality. To me, it seems like what we're doing is we're acknowledging that we have an inner morality. We're acknowledging that we're not getting the morality from the book. We're using our morality to decide how we're going to twist things to make it suitable to us. So that to me itself says a lot. But overall, I do think that as far as even if we differ on certain things where we can have debates at universities to talk about those issues and agree to disagree and then go out for drinks afterwards, you know, beer for me, skim milk for you. It's like, whatever. I'm kidding. I was like, I know a lot of Muslims drink too. So I think that we are aligned when it comes to our goals. On the other aspect, when you were talking, I just want to bring up this one point that you said, you know, about the good things that, you know, Christians are doing, that Muslims are doing in terms of charity and good work. So I want to just bring up the Christopher Hitchens challenge. And this is one thing that he said is, first of all, good people do good things, bad people do bad things, as Steven Weinberg said. And there are plenty of bad things that have been done by religious people and non-religious people. But what Hitch would do is he would ask his audience many times that he would say, name one good or moral act that religious people do that are non-believer, that cannot be done by a non-believer. And nobody had a single answer. So when it comes to charity, when it comes to philanthropy and doing all those good works, I mean, atheists and non-believers do them they're capable of doing them, and they do them just as much as believers do. Then he would ask a second part to the question, which is, name a wicked or immoral act that can only be done by a religious person, right, and would not be done by a non-believer. And when it comes to that, everyone here can name, you know, a whole range of things. And then if you take that and you combine it, you know, with the third part of this, which is that, you know, both religious and non-religious people do good and bad things, then in my view, I would conclude that religion at the very least, right, is unnecessary because it balances out, and at the very most is a net negative for humanity. So that's just as far as the theology and the belief aspect of it goes. But again, when it comes to alignment on goals, like, I solidarity with you, I completely support everything that you do, and I'm very happy that people like you exist. And that's, we need people, more people like you in the Muslim world.
What they're trying to do is negotiate the non-negotiables.
Right.
And the first thing is that the Quran is not inerrant.
But that's, yeah. We're already on the same page. Yeah, there you go. I think that's a first step to, you know, when you talked about the Reformation aspect and whether you can have a secular Islam, a secular means, or secular Muslims, actually, secular means separation of religion and state. And like all of these Abrahamic religions, they're inherently political. So throughout history, to separate that in any of them has taken a lot of work, you know, to be able to make them into something non-political and more private and more personal. So thank you.
You were talking about the internet being such a release for people and how it led to the Arab Spring. Mm-hmm. And is there a possibility of an Arab Spring ever happening in Saudi Arabia or Iran?
I think it is. Well, Iran is, it wouldn't be the Arab Spring, it would be more of a Persian Spring, which is, I think, a kind of a water source. But anyway, I think it's already happened. There's a lot of dissidents in Saudi Arabia already as it is. The Arab Spring is interesting because I think a lot of people are very impatient with it. One of the things to understand about the history of that region is that they're very skeptical about secularism. Like what we understand, we associate secularism with open-mindedness and liberal thought and enlightenment and so on. But over there, secularism was like their last great Islamic caliphate, which was the Ottoman Empire. Kemal Atatürk, who's a famous secularist who basically invented modern-day Turkey, put the last nail in the coffin of that empire. All of the dictators forced secularism onto the people. When you look at imperialism or, you know, Western colonization and so on, like that was, they also look at that as forced secularism. They look at, so there's, their association with secularism is more of a, they associate it with more with dictators. The Shah of Iran is an example where the Shah of Iran was, you know, US supported, was fiercely secular. As well as all of the other, you know, Gaddafi and Assad and Mubarak and all of these people, and Saddam Hussein. So what has happened is that during the entire time that these dictators have been in place, the only organized opposition to them that has been able to develop is the Islamists, because the Islamists actually have the courage to speak out. They, you know, often provide social services to people and so on. So the rest of the groups haven't really been able to get organized in a way without being quashed. So whenever you have a vacuum that develops with the fall of Mubarak, the Muslim Brotherhood gets elected to power because they just have a very organized structure, even if a lot of people are more secular than not. In Israel, Hamas, for instance, in Palestine, Hamas has a lot of organization. You know, they provide, healthcare, food, social services to their people, whereas Fatah, which is secular, is widely corrupt. So many people, even if they're secular, if they're living there, if you're living there all your life and you're dependent on, you know, the well-being of your children, often you choose the lesser of the two evils, which would be going for the less corrupt thing. So there's a, they're very skeptical to a large extent about secularism. It just doesn't mean the same thing to them as it does to us. I forgot what, so you were, your question was, I started veering off. The Arab Spring. So I do think that it can happen. I think it'll take a lot more patience on our part to see it come through. And one of the examples, one of the countries that's ahead on this is Iran. So Iran, you know, had a secular dictator, the Shah. The moment he came out, it was a vacuum filled by an Islamist government, which was the Khomeini. And now already we're seeing sort of cracks in the clerical establishment. The people of Iran actually are widely known to be very pro-secular. They're probably one of the most pro-American, pro-Western populations in the Muslim world overall, which is why you see a lot of Western governments kind of investing in them. They're kind of buying out time until the old timers and the hardliners die out, you know, and then they come to prominence. The population gets more control and more of a voice. So it does take time. You're not going to see it immediately. Again, the majority of these people are under the age of 35. All they've seen is the dictators that have been there, entrenched there for 30, 40 years. So when it falls, they don't really know what to do. It's not something that they're used to. So they have to kind of navigate on their own. In Saudi Arabia, when you do see that, I think that's, I don't know when it's going to happen. It'll probably require a lot more, especially less U.S. support, because the U.S. supports Saudi Arabia a lot because the U.S. is dependent on them for oil, which is why I think like alternative energy, you know, investing in that is actually a national security issue. It's not just, you know, an environmental issue and so on. So I think it'll take time, but I do think it's already happening. There's already the rumblings of it underground.
That was wonderful, right, everybody? Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
The real question is not how do we prove people wrong, but how do we learn to meet their most basic human needs? Using reason instead of the myths that we no longer believe in. The needs are the same. If you want to change people's minds, you've got to change their lives.